I'd like to do is take those on the call today through a bit of a discussion of what Trilogy is and just highlight the value proposition for the company. As you said, Trilogy is listed on the Toronto and New York Stock Exchange under the ticker symbol TMQ. I invite people to go to our website, trilogymetals.com, for a copy of a presentation and more information on the company. What we're focused on is the Ambler Mining District, which is located in the great state of Alaska. And I'm going to be talking today about that district, the high-grade nature of our two development projects there, the jurisdiction considerations, and the partnerships that we have. So with that, let me get started. I've got a forward-looking statement here, which just highlights that I will be making some forward-looking statements during the course of my comments. So just on a summary basis, Trilogy has a 50% interest in the Ambler Mining District. That district consists of 8 billion pounds of copper, 3 billion pounds of zinc, and over 1 million ounces of precious metals. As I indicated, it's located in Alaska. We've got significant exploration upside. We're talking about high-grade copper. Our Arctic deposit has 43.4 million tons at approximately just over 4% copper equivalent. So this is a very high-grade copper deposit. And in addition, we have a second deposit called Bornite, which is a development project, which is similarly not as high grade as Arctic, but has a significant potential in terms of growth, but also is considered high grade from a strictly copper perspective. So we're in a very good jurisdiction, and I'll get into some of the specifics about what's driving the story. In terms of share capitalization, we're sitting on about $13 million in cash at the corporate level. We don't have any debt. In addition, we have this 50% interest in the JV, and that was created through South 32, which is a large Australian mining company making a $145 million investment into the company to acquire its 50% interest in the Ambler Mining District. So our share of that cash is $72.5 million, but the JV itself is sitting with that $145, which really puts us in a position where the joint venture Ambler Metals will be advancing the Ambler Mining District, and it's funded for the next 4 years, possibly five, depending on how things advance in terms of the development of the district. We have significant major shareholders that have been very supportive. So in total, when you look at the shareholder base, we've got approximately 65% of the shares are held by the major shareholders, including management, only 2%, and South 32 having an 11.5% interest as well. Directly in the company. I mentioned three partnerships, so I'd like to just walk through those quickly. South 32 is our joint venture partner in the district. In total, South 32 has invested about $200 million to acquire its interest in Trilogy and to acquire its interest in the district. In addition, they also funded $30 million of exploration over a three-year time period. So effectively, they've done the due diligence on the district as a result of the exploration that they put in, and that was before they made the $145 million investment, which occurred in January of 2020. Our second partnership is with NANA. NANA is a native corporation located in the northwest part of the state of Alaska. They have a rich mining history. For those of you that know Alaska, you'll know that NANA is the owner of the ground where Red Dog is located. Red Dog's operated by Teck. It's the largest zinc mine in the world. So NANA has a rich mining history. And we created a joint venture with NANA in 2011 where we put in our lands and they put in their exploration lands. We created a JV. So NANA is part of a partnership with ourselves in South 32. And they have the ability to participate directly in the development of the assets in the jurisdiction, and they can either take a direct interest or they can take a net profit interest. And I'm happy to go into more details on that if there's any questions. The third partnership is with the state of Alaska and specifically with ADA. ADA is a development agency in the state, and they're very focused on infrastructure. And the key to unlocking the Ambler Mining District is the missing link, which is a road to open up the district. There's already an existing port facility in Anchorage. There's a Dalton Highway, which runs north-south through the state. There's a rail link from Fairbanks to Anchorage. But what we need is a road that goes into the district, and our partnership with ADA is focused on bringing that road to reality, and I'll talk a little bit more about where we are in that. So the road itself is highlighted on this page, 211-mile road into the Ambler Mining District. We received a record of decision in 2020, and most recently we just got the right-of-ways from the BLM and National Park Service. And the next step in terms of development of a road is to fund the feasibility study associated with the road. We hope to announce that shortly. In terms of where that road permitting process is, as I indicated, we've got the record of decision. The next stage for ADA is the detailed engineering, the financing, and construction. This is where the road would run through. All of those dots and stars or targets or opportunities that we have in the district, with the star at Arctic and Bornite being highlighted. Smucker is owned by Teck. Sun is privately owned. This is our most advanced project. We have a feasibility study on this project, which was prepared by Trilogy. It's 43.4 million tons at 4.2% copper equivalent. As I said, we did a feasibility study and we announced that last year. It's a 12-year mine life with an NPV at the spot prices or the base case prices that are noted of $1.1 billion. We've run that NPV based on current spot prices, and it's approached $1.9 billion on an after-tax basis at an 8% discount. So this is a robust operation, and this is what we expect to be the first project, hopefully of many, within the district as we advance it. And it would be definitely low-cost copper once you factor in the other metals that would be produced. This is what Arctic would look like. It's a small footprint. You can see the open pit to the right, tailings facility top left, and the infrastructure in the valley. What we're really looking at now is how Bornite could fit into Arctic longer term, but also the district potential that we have in terms of exploration. Our plan this year is to commence the permitting process for Arctic. We expect that process to be somewhere between 30 and 36 months. It's going to be focused primarily on state permits. There's one federal permit that we require. It's a 404 wetlands permit, but we're not on any federal land, so it's really focused on the state permits that we'll be looking at. But our expectation is that as we work through the process, we're looking at a roughly 30 to 36 month time period to advance the permitting process, which will then put us into making an investment decision somewhere around the end of 2023, early 2024. I mentioned exploration potential in the district. It's a large district, so we have lots of opportunities here. Bornite already has an identified resource, both indicated and inferred, of about 180 million tons, grading around 1.5% copper. So it's a large opportunity. But in addition to that, there's a number of satellite deposits, Smucker, Horse Creek, Sunshine, Chanak, BT, that we hope will all ultimately be processed through the Arctic Mill in the future and take that mine life from something like 12 years to hopefully something like 20 plus years. And that's before we factor in Bornite going forward. This is a VTEM survey that was run in 2019, and just highlighting some of the targets. The red dots are targets that we're looking at. And our plan for 2021 is to have an enhanced exploration program. We're looking to spend about $27 million as part of that program this year, drilling about 14,700 meters. We didn't have an exploration program in 2020 because of COVID, made the difficult decision to not have that program. So we're looking to obviously get back out in the field and do as much exploration as possible. The district is, and particularly Arctic itself, is a VMS deposit. So we think it compares favorably to deposits elsewhere, Flin Flon, Noranda being two good examples in Canada, that obviously have had multi-decade mine lives, and we see the Bornite Ambler District as being very similar to that going forward. In terms of upcoming catalysts, I would say the key focuses are going to be on optimizing the feasibility study that Trilogy prepared. So Ambler Metals is in the process of looking at that study, optimizing it, advancing it, moving it forward. So we're hopeful that that will occur over the next several months. We're looking to enter into an agreement with ADA on the Ambler Road, which would help fund the detailed engineering associated with advancing the road. As I mentioned, we just, or ADA just received the right-of-ways from BLM and from National Park Service. So the next step is this agreement with ADA to look at the funding of a road, which we would expect to share with them. We have a drilling campaign expected to start in May, and then we expect to commence the permitting of the Arctic project later this year. So even though we had a great year in 2020, it really wasn't reflected in the share price. And I think in some respects, it was a lack of drilling that we had in 2020 that had an impact. But coming back to Joe's comments on exploration development companies, we think we're very well placed, given that we have high grade opportunity in a district where there's significant upside potential for further exploration, further discoveries. And we're well funded with a very strong partner, South 32. We're in a position where we don't need to raise money for a number of years. And we've got a strong partnership with NANA and ADA. So we think we're in a very strong position. And then just briefly speaking about copper, I think Joe's given a good overview of the space. But when you look at where copper is today, it's had a nice run up into the 360 level. Certainly looks like it wants to move higher. I think when you look at the supply-demand fundamentals, it's very positive, particularly when you factor in the EV market and infrastructure development that will be likely going forward, particularly given some of the planned initiatives with the new administration in Washington.